Welcome back to The Breakfast on PLOS TV Africa. Our next conversation this morning is on the petroleum industry bill. The last time we spoke about this, it was a chaos at the hearing when members and leaders of the host communities got into a fight. But of course, now we're moving into a totally different direction. Once again, on the petroleum industry bill, governors of the South-South have stated that 2.5% host community fund is inadequate, and they've requested for 10% instead. We're speaking this morning with Emeka Okpara, who's joining us, and of course to share his thoughts on this. Good morning. Thanks for joining us, sir.
Good morning.
All right. Let's start with, you know, your views on 2.5% to 10%. Do you think the South-South governors have a strong point for demanding 10% host community funds?
Yes, I think they do. In all ramifications, but my problem is not necessarily on that amount. The thing is that these are just little aspects of federalism, and we should not be taking them piecemeal. Otherwise, we get them wrong. I think they are justified, but we should not just stop there. When it gets to the state, what happens to it? That is the point for me. You understand? But as to whether they are justified, I think absolutely they are.
Okay. And go further. You know, now let's talk about what happens when they get to the states, because that's where a larger part of this conversation, I believe, should be. Over time, we've had numerous conversations on the NDDC and the amount of money that has been invested and has gone through the NDDC. And, of course, looking out for where that money has been beneficial to residents and people of the South-South and the Niger Delta. And so is this, you know, another time to bring back that conversation? How much money has been invested in the Niger Delta and in the South-South communities? And what are the, you know, the results?
Yeah, it's good that you've introduced the issue of the NDDC. I think we should look at it from that backdrop. It is not, it is very simplistic to blame the non-development of the oil communities on the oil communities or the states that constitute the oil communities. If you look at the NDDC, you find out that it is not actually being controlled by the people whom it should benefit. It is all the strings are being pulled from Abuja. And that is the problem with the kind of federalism, actually unitary system dressed up as pre-federalism that we are practicing. Now, what we need to do is to make sure that every state should have its own constitution. And we should have a template for this. We should also have a template for community constitutions. It should go down to the communities, go down to every town, every village. You understand? The states and the federal governments can be able to work together and have a template depending on the kind of culture of the people, because you cannot impose the same kind of template you have here in the South on the North and vice versa. You shouldn't do it. So the problem is not with the funds or the percentage of the funds that is earmarked for oil communities. The problem is, how do we make sure that all these things are done in such a way that not somebody from Abuja will be pulling the strings in the communities, and the person that is supposed to be handling the funds and disbursing the funds in the communities does not owe allegiance to Abuja. In fact, even against the state government, even against his community, that is the problem. That is the root of all these problems. So if the person feels he is protected from Abuja, then he can, with impunity, treat the funds anyhow, embezzle them, use them any way he or she feels like, and feels protected by Abuja.
But we
understand
what you're saying, Mr. Okpara. What you're saying is that the billions and billions of naira that has been sent through the NDDC for the betterment of the lives of the Niger Delta people. What you're saying this morning is that you can't really blame people of the Niger Delta and public, you know, office holders and people in positions of power in the Niger Delta for the inability of those funds to be used appropriately for the Niger Delta people.
I do not think that the greater part of the blame should be theirs. Of course, I would say they have some blame, they have to share of the blame. But the greater blame is on the kind of federalism or the unitary system dressed up as federalism that we are practicing. That is the point. If we get it right, then, okay, look at this scenario. If somebody commits an offense in Bayelsa State, the strings, whether he will be convicted or not, will depend on Abuja. It's not supposed to be so. If we allow the states to develop in all our ramifications, develop their own justice system in accordance with the template that is generated by the Constitution, if we allow that to happen, and we do not allow interference from Abuja, when Abuja will say, look, the next government or the next governor or the next local government chairman that will come here, look, we want you, we don't want you to probe the former person because the former person is our man. The condition for us allowing you to become the governor or to become the local government chairman is if you don't probe this person. If we don't allow that to continue to happen, then we'll get the system right. We'll get it right. Because I believe when you come down to the communities will be able to develop over time a system that they will be able to sanction criminally and in whatever way that is legally possible anybody that misuses the funds meant for the community.
You definitely have a point there. But I would before we go into talking about what the possible benefits would be if they give them and approve the 10%, if we live in a society where systems work and funds were used adequately, I just will quickly mention that, yes, you might argue that, you know, the system that we run, the fact that, of course, Abuja controls a lot of these details here and there, might be putting clogs in the wheel of, you know, making the lives of the people of Niger Delta better. But it's almost the same thing as, I remember in the past I've had arguments about the amount of money that was budgeted for roads in the southeast that eventually didn't get approved by the government, budgeted for airports, budgeted for so much, you know, that was meant to be going to the south that it didn't get government approval. But still, there were representatives of people of the southeast in the National Assembly that not at any point did they complain and you know, cry out to their people that we're representing you here. There's a lot of money that gets into the budget everywhere, but it's never released. They sat down there for years and years and years and didn't say anything. So it's about the same thing with the Niger Delta representatives. Whoever they are in the National Assembly and even in the states, they've not been able to tell their people that the reason these projects are not done, the reason we've not been able to improve on your lives is because Abuja keeps blocking these funds from getting there. It's a totally different conversation. I want us to talk about what the possibilities are if these, if 10% host community funds are approved. What are the things that can be achieved for the people of the Niger Delta?
Now, you made mention of, let's say, what we have to have in mind is that the National Assembly members, the National Assembly is there principally for lawmaking. And you find out that if you also look at the rules governing debates and all that in the National Assembly is key to make sure that progressive voices are not allowed to come up properly. So that is that. Now, if you take, let's say, the Southeast you are talking about as an example, you find out that, okay, there is a governor in the Southeast imposed from Abuja, not voted by the people. That is the same thing we are talking about. Now, he feels he doesn't owe allegiance to the state that he's governing. Now, okay, now you find out that something happened in the previous administration and a judicial commission of inquiry was set by the former governor on lands and contracts. And eventually, this present government inherited it. Now, what we are hearing is that there are pressures being put from Abuja to make sure that what has been achieved so far in making sure that there is accountability by the former governor who looted the state dry, the cause of justice is at least muted to a very large extent. That is what we're happening. And what that's the same thing we are saying. If the governments in the Southeast and in everywhere, actually in every state, if our votes should count and they know that they owe allegiance and that there will be sanctions by the people, one way or the other, that they are governing, then I think we'll get everything right. Over time, we'll get it right. But when there is superimposition from Abuja, and there is that influence, even when they do anything, there is impunity being propagated and being maintained from Abuja, we cannot get it right. That is the point. That is the crux of this whole thing. Okay. If we get it right on the system we are, so that the person in Otugbo who is the local government chairman in Otugbo, the President General of my town union, in my own village, in my own town, know that there is no influence that will give him impunity when he exists there, or even while he is performing. Then he will do what the people want, and he will do things in accordance with the wishes of the people and in accordance with the law. That is the point. That is the problem we are having.
Okay, so at that meeting that governors of South-South had in Port Harcourt, the chairman of the South-South Forum and governor of Delta State, Ifeanyi Okowa, clarified that the 2.5% is inadequate and that they're demanding a 10% increase or increase to 10% for the benefit of the community. For the benefit of all those who might not understand, the import, what was Okowa trying to say in terms of how much benefit this will bring to the host communities in the Niger Delta?
Yeah, there's no way that an increase will not somehow trickle down to the community. It will happen. And I want to stress it that it is not the incumbent upon those who are outside those communities to determine for them how they will use the funds that is available for them. And one other thing, if the gold in Zamfara and all the solid minerals that have been found in the north belong to those people and belong to, they disburse it the way their culture permits, it should not be proper for somebody from somewhere to come and tell the oil communities, this is how you are going to do your funds. We feel you are not going to do it well, so we return it here in the center. It's not supposed to be so. And I think the governors are being modest in that demand of 10%. And I think we should give it to the host communities. And what we should insist is that we should develop a system that will make whoever comes into control of these funds to be accountable to the people. And that is why we are talking about proper federalism. We should not be doing these things piecemeal. When we do them piecemeal this way, and we leave the main issue, we will not be able to get it right. And we'll turn around and blame, the funds have been coming to the communities. What have you been doing with them and all that and all that. That shouldn't be the issue. The issue is let us get the system right. And every other thing will fall in place.
All right. So you're suggesting even higher than 10%, maybe 20, 30, maybe even 50%.
Yeah. Because now the whole world has gone into municipal government. It should, when they compute what belongs to community A, community B, it goes to the body, majorly, the body that governs that community. And that is why the federal government should hands off a lot of items that is now left in the exclusive legislative list. And also, even in the concurrent legislative list, they
I think we may have lost him there. The conversation this morning is about the petroleum industry bill. Governors of the South-South, of course, headed by Ifeanyi Okowa of Delta State, have demanded an increment from 2.5% to 10% of the host community funds. There are arguments of, you know, what exactly those funds could be used for, what the people of the Niger Delta will benefit, you know, if we get up to 10% or if they get up to 10% host community funds. We cannot leave out the part where the people of the Niger Delta would continue, of course, to encourage their representatives in the National Assembly, in Government House, in the local government offices, to ensure that they have been described really as the people who provide 80 to 90% of Nigeria's finances should benefit a whole lot more from the oil that leaves their land. And he was indeed making that statement just now, of course, referring once again to Zamfara, which has always been mentioned because of the gold and mineral resources that are gotten from there. And so why is the Niger Delta's oil not given the same treatment?
Yes, and looking at how, you know, resources are distributed in Nigeria, you know, the parts of the country that are blessed with what resources and the Niger Delta, one would assume, just reading about the riches, the oil wealth in the Niger Delta, that that place would be beautifully developed. But it's just a shame, you know, looking at how much of a very poor state that area is, and how, you know, lots of analysts would argue that the NDDC has looted funds that should go, you know, just should be channeled into the development of Nigeria and the Niger Delta, and how it's been looted into comatose, because right now for about a year, it's been headed by an interim committee. I don't know if we have our guests now.
Well, it's not just the NDDC. There's also the governors of the South-South, governors of the Niger Delta. There's also the local government chairman that exists in the Niger Delta, because, you know, I would always say, and a reminder, that every local government in Nigeria gets an average of 140 to 200 million, sometimes even more, every month. And so if the communities in the Niger Delta don't see where these funds go into every month, then we cannot blame just the NDDC. We'll blame their governors, we'll blame their local government chairman. We'll find out, and we, you know, these are questions that must be asked. What exactly does that, or where exactly does that money go into? You know, there used to be a way that you could quickly check how much every local government in Nigeria receives every month. They give you like a 3 month, the last 3 months details of how much we received. And if you look at it, you would never see anyone that is less than 100 million every month. And so it tells you that every year, each local government receives billions of naira, 2 billion, 3 billion naira every year. That cannot be accounted for, that you cannot see what the local government chairman really has achieved with those funds.
Anyway, I actually paid a visit to where I grew up, you know, just recently, and I was shocked to see how many years later it's still the way it is. And I just kept asking myself, where is the local government chairman and what is he doing exactly?
Peter Okpara, thank you very much for joining us this morning and for speaking with us. Of course, for also getting into other perspectives of this conversation, we totally appreciate it. Emeka Okpara, I beg your pardon, I was still looking out for Peter Esele. Thank you very much, sir. I'm not sure if you can still hear us. All right, I think that's where we wrap things up this morning.
Yes, yes, indeed. I hope you've enjoyed the conversation today, beginning with the Eastern Railway project and how the federal government, you know, is making sure that all our rail lines are, you know, up and running. And also we talked about the labor protest and just all the angles to the conversation regarding the minimum wage movement from the exclusive legislative list to the concurrent list, what the grievances of labor are. And lastly, we've been talking about the petroleum industry bill, development of the Niger Delta, and the demand of the South-South governors to move this up to 10% for the community fund.
National Assembly says very likely will be signed by April, so let's also keep our fingers crossed and see how that goes. Thank you so much for joining us. If you missed out on any of these conversations, of course, follow us on social media at Plus TV Africa, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and also subscribe to our YouTube channel at Plus TV Africa. I am Usau Gie Ogbon.
And I am Aneta Felix. Have a great day.